Well, biological is one of these products that are considered a natural type product. Most of these biologicals that are used in crop production are originate from microorganisms in the soil or possibly plant products. And they're primarily for plant health benefits, plant nutrition, plant growth regulation, or in other words, plant growth stimulants. Most of these are commercialized, and it's not necessarily that the crops are missing something, but they do enhance a particular component that might be limited or lacking in the overall growth of the plant.
These aren't just bugs in a jug, are they?
Well,
or some are.
Some are bugs in the jug, and a good example of that, probably the first ones that are now considered a biological product, or also known as biofertilizers, would be the rhizobium that were used as legume inoculants that have been developed 100 years ago. Also, live fungi such as the symbiotic mycorrhizae that are associated with roots of most plants have been developed and are included in some of these live products. So, you know, that tells you one thing, is you have to be very careful with these when you're using them. You don't want to expose them to a lot of heat or a lot of, salt-based fertilizers, because they are susceptible to those and they could die, and then you would not get anything out of them.
Now, others, like what we're doing out here, are vitamins and enzymes and that sort of thing, correct?
Yeah, that's right. They're all, they're either plant-based or microbial-based. In fact, the product we're using out here, one of the components is from a marine algae, the steroid-based plant regulator. It also has a whole range of B vitamins, and there's also a long-chain fatty acid that enhances chloroplast development in these plants. In other words, the organelles that harvest light from the sun and in the process of photosynthesis. So it's very beneficial if you can increase the number of these chlorophyll-containing organs that are called chloroplasts. You should be able to increase productivity.
That's why we not only do we put this on the seed when we plant it or in the seed furrow, we also spray the foliar.
Right, because it's a multifunctional type biostimulant or biological product. You know, some, for instance, the B vitamins are usually associated with microorganisms in the soil that produce these and are taken up by the plant. So if you could get them as the seed begins to germinate and emerge, you have the B vitamins there to help them with their metabolism. Whereas, and then you hit them, you apply this product again during the foliar stage or the vegetative stage on leaves, they'll take up these products, and of course by that time you're producing chloroplasts, and that component will kick in and stimulate hopefully more chloroplast, more chlorophyll development as well.
So you mentioned that these aren't true biologicals, they're like prebiotics.
Right, right. You can consider, you know, if people who are dieting now use a lot of probiotics. So the living organisms in these biological products could be considered a probiotic biological product. What we're using here, which are products that do not have microorganisms in them, would be considered prebiotics. And what a prebiotic does is help feed not only the plant, but also the microorganisms in the root zone of these plants, stimulate them to produce more of their plant growth promoting compounds that helps the plant. So in a way, we've evolved with these products. It's not only specifically for plant growth, but we're also enhancing soil health. And microorganisms in the soil is obviously a very major component of soil health, and we get these biostimulants going in the plant. The they exude a lot of these exudates or compounds that feed the microorganisms, and we're helping improve soil health. At the same time, we're improving plant growth.
So that's why you're measuring, we've looked at plants, you got soil that you're going to do the soil properties on, soil health indicators, including the different bacteria and fungi and all the different other soil organisms.
Yeah, that's right. That's why we not only, from the plant component, we're taking chlorophyll or chloroplast readings for photosynthesis, and we're looking at what amount of carbon is being released through the roots into the soil to feed the microbes. But then, like you say, we're also monitoring the major components of the soil microbial population, or the microbiome in the soil, to see how the plant is influencing that. In fact, one of the functions of this biostimulant is to stimulate root growth. If we get a lot larger root mass when we're using this particular biological product, and when you get a larger root mass, you're going to have a lot more microorganisms, probably more diverse and a lot more functional in the soil, that is helping plant growth and also overall soil fertility and soil health.
So out here, you're also then doing a fertility study. Right. Along with the prebiotic, you got different fertility systems to see if you can get by with less fertility when you use this prebiotic or probiotic.
Right, yeah, that's right. The idea is that if you can get the plant to perform a lot better using these biological products, it should be more efficient in fertilizer use. So we've got a different fertilizer levels or fertilizer rates out here, and we want to see if the nitrogen use efficiency is improved by using the biological stimulant, the biological product, and if that's the case, we may be able to reduce the amount of synthetic fertilizer that is required to bring the crop to the same level of productivity that you would with, say, a recommended rate.
So, is it true that, because you mentioned about compounds from the plant to the root system, they can go 20 up to 30 or 40% of all the photosynthetic carbon they fix winds up out in the rhizosphere?
All right, yeah, that's right. The plant itself fixes a lot of carbon dioxide from the air, not only for its own nutrition, but it will release an amount, depending on the plant species, it ranges anywhere from 20 to 50% of the carbon that's fixed from the air is released into the soil, primarily to feed the microbes, but also to build soil organic matter, and in a way, sequester carbon. We're talking about carbon sequestration and carbon farming now. This is another manner of helping that out, is using some of these biological products that can enhance that particular function. And we've looked at different fractions of carbon that's going into the soil, the directly out of the roots, which is very soluble type carbons, like sugars, simple sugars, amino acids, organic acids. We can measure that. It's very labile, it's readily available to the microorganisms in the soil, and it's very beneficial for the plant. And then we're also looking at the amount of carbon that is from more fibrous material, but that takes a little more longer to decompose, but it's helpful to maintain the microbial community there. And it is used up a little bit slower over time. Then, of course, you've got the more stable organic matter that is decomposed over time and then builds up soil organic matter over the season and into the next year.
So can a plant regulate which compounds it releases for what it needs?
There is some thought that it does. If there's a certain component in the microbial community that is limited, there are certain compounds that can be released that will signal the certain types of microbes to develop and become abundant and then perform their function for the plant. And on the other hand, these plants can also release some signals that are to ward off certain pathogens that might try to shift the microbial balance in the soil and cause root rots and those kinds of diseases. So there's a very delicate balance between the beneficial and the detrimental in the soil. And that is another thing that these biological products perform, is to simulate the beneficial microbes to ward off those pathogenic types that could be detrimental to the overall plant growth or plant health.